All right, we are back for another virtual interview, and we're here with Stacy. Stacy, thanks for joining me today.
It's a pleasure. Thank you.
Now, for folks out there watching, maybe give a little bit on your background, and I'd love to hear how you got into QA.
Sure. Well, from an early age, I loved coding, and I thought I was going to be a software developer. I went to school for computer science, and I had the opportunity to do an internship in QA for Remedy Corporation, and I fell in love with it. I loved the idea of being able to look at a product and identify how we could make it better.
Yeah.
And I thought I could use my experience as a developer to really innovate on how QA was doing, because even at that point, they gave me a stack of test cases that was this high, printed out, and I ran through it one time and was like, you know what? I've got to figure out a way that I don't have to run through that again. And so I've spent my career, so it's been, that was 20 years ago.
Yeah.
I spent my career really figuring out how can we do QA in the most innovative ways possible.
Yeah.
And so every product, every company that I've worked with, we have created tools, automation, I probably used every tool known to man, but I just love that QA really gives a product its life and its beauty and its perspective, and that's been my joy.
Yeah, that is so interesting. It's funny, I was talking to someone else the other day, and he did exactly the same thing. It was, you know, he had this stack of work to do, and he's like, oh, it's all manual, and I'm running through it, and he's like, okay, I'm not doing that again. So on his own, without anyone, you know, prodding or poking him to do it, said, hey, how do I make this more efficient? And he automated it. Yeah. And it was really interesting. The company he was working for was like, oh, that's great. And he literally automated it, and it took him, you know, half an hour or whatever once he was done automating to run his stuff. It was really short. And now he had all this time, and they're like, okay, well, in a couple hours or in a couple days, we'll give you some more work, right? Because they're not sure how to handle that yet, right? Always. And so I think organizations who get used to and comfortable with the idea of we should try and get more efficient, and if we can, embrace that, right? Embrace people that are open to trying new things and new ways of doing things. I know you had a session here on full stack testing.
Yeah.
And with transferring to the digital era and, you know, having all of these digital media platforms that we need to be operating on, what are you seeing as some advantages and how to get started if people aren't already, which they may be, but if they're not, how do we get started with full stack testing and thinking about that?
Sure. Well, I started using the word full stack testing because I have a lot of friends that are full stack developers.
Yeah.
And they started as front end developers with JavaScript. And Node.js has allowed them to now use their JavaScript for back end development as well.
Yeah.
So they've become full stack. And I have always enjoyed being a back-end tester. I like the database, the APIs. I didn't really so much enjoy doing the front end.
Yeah.
And so I said, oh, wow, now there's an opportunity for not just me, but my peers in QA to get an opportunity full stack.
Yes.
They can do exactly what my front-end developers have done and test at every different level and be able to do that because the tools and the open source community has grown so much that it allows them now to not only create end-to-end UI front-end automation tests, but you can now do API testing and you can do performance testing and you can get your hands dirty in the database, and it's as simple as it was for my front-end developers to become full stack.
Yeah.
So that's my conversation and my presentation yesterday was just about, listen, we now can call ourselves full stack too.
Yeah.
We don't just have to be on the front end and embrace it, enjoy it. And and it's just a new way to increase your experience and your skill set as well.
Yeah. So for some of those folks out there who say this, you know, they may be feeling the same thing. They're like, love the APIs, love the back end, love getting in dirty in the technology and the data and all of that on the backside. So now using tools like Node.js can help them, you know, go full stack again, just like the developers are, and keeping up with that skill set. For someone who is just getting into that or hasn't done it, are there any tips or places to go to get information on that that were really helpful as you were exploring that?
Absolutely. One of the other things I love about Node is that it's very easy. Mm-hmm. In comparison, JavaScript is the easier language to learn.
Yes.
And the community is very into sharing best mm-hmm. practices and documentation. I've seen some of the best wikis and the best documentation with the Node modules. So I encourage people that are new to automation, if you have to pick a language, JavaScript's going to be one of your easier ones.
Yeah.
And the modules that you create and the frameworks and the tools, they all come with a wealth of examples.
Yeah.
I tell people if you're interested, Nightwatch is one of the frameworks that we started with, and I encourage some of my clients, if you have people that are a little nervous and scared of getting started, Nightwatch makes it very simple. You go to their site, you can pull down their sample code and have automation running in 10, 20 minutes.
Yeah.
And then you feel a little bit better and you can start to learn a little bit more. One of the tips that I give to my clients and when I give presentation is there's so much to learn, you get overwhelmed. Don't do that.
Don't do that.
Most languages, especially with automation, there's 10, probably like 10 calls that you're going to make.
Yeah.
You're going to enter data, you're going to check data, you're going to go to a site, especially if it's with web application, you're going to go to a site and you're going to do a validation, which a verifier cert.
Yeah.
So you can do 80% of your automation with those 10. So don't get overwhelmed. Get you a checklist, a check sheet of those 10 and try going your first year with just those 10. And when you build up your confidence, then you can learn about all the other ways that you can expand your automation.
Right. So good tip there for folks out there saying, you know, I want to get started. It seems overwhelming, right? Because a tendency for a lot of folks in testing is they want to get all the information, right? And then when you start to do that, there's lots of it out there and you can quickly get overwhelmed with how much data and information is available. So start with those 10. I think that's a great tip of, you know, start with the basics and, you know, look at those, leverage those for a while until you get comfortable and then branch out.
Absolutely.
Yeah, so that's a great tip for folks out there that are looking at how do I get started doing that. Would be interesting. Have you been to this conference before?
This is my first time. It's my first time. I've always wanted to go. It was either not in the budget or some conflicts. And I live pretty close by, so I'm so excited to be here. I'll never miss another one. It's really great.
Now, so for folks again watching that don't have a chance to be here, and being that it is your first time, right, you're seeing all this for the first time, can you maybe describe to them or give them some insight into what you've enjoyed so much about being here in person and taking advantage of while you're at the conference?
Yeah. Well, many of us in the QA world are not a part of these large QA departments.
Right.
We're one of very few. And we wonder, are we going crazy? Are we mad?
Yeah. Is anyone else thinking this, or is it just me?
And the atmosphere here is just so great because there's so many conversations about, I wrote my automation to do that, and it failed in that same area. How did you resolve it?
Yeah.
And you really are learning not only how to solve your issues, but you're just feeling good to know that there's other people out there that are thinking innovatively, are hitting some of the challenges, and you can bond and feel good that, you know what, even if you go back to your smaller teams, or even if it's a large team, you can know that your ideas and what you've been thinking can be validated by your peers.
Yeah, because it does. It gives you, some of those ideas you've been thinking, you can bounce off lots of other people who probably are thinking, you know, along the same lines or other similar things, and get that feedback, right? And then you go, okay, this is great. And I would be curious on your perspective about this, but what I've seen here is you get a renewed energy, right?
Absolutely.
So you go back energized about the things that you're thinking about because you now have this community of people that you've connected with that you feel like, I'm not alone, right?
Yes.
There's a larger group out there. So it's great for that networking and that connection.
Yeah, I've made a lot of friends already.
Yeah.
And I'm like, if you have that problem, call me. And if I have that problem, I'm calling you.
Yeah, exactly.
Which is good. And that's what it's great about the kind of the open source community and just how technology is progressing, is we're a community. There's no reason why we have to kind of, if we have a solution, we have to keep it to ourselves anymore.
You don't need to isolate it.
Everyone needs to evolve. We all are going on the same path, so let's share our best practices as much as possible.
Absolutely, and I think for folks out there that maybe aren't using open source yet or are hesitant to use open source, it's evolved a lot, right? I mean, from when open source first was introduced to today, you know, like, I know some people are calling it phase two of open source, but like the new version that's out there of different open source tools, what's maybe some of your experience has been with open source and the ability to get access to, like you said, wikis and information and stuff for folks that haven't checked into some of the open source tools.
Sure.
Who are still saying, oh, I'm using all these package tools.
Third party, paid. And you know, even if you are using those sites like Stack Overflow, it's almost, and I use the word open source, but I really mean open community.
Yes.
And so that's more inclusive of not just the source, not just the products, but just the idea of, if I have a problem, I'm going to help you, and let's see if you can do the same.
Yes.
And just moving towards that. But I've loved, what I do love about the open source is that you, as a technical person, have an opportunity to give your feedback. Mm-hmm. You have an opportunity to submit your own code and your own revisions, and feel as if you're part of something bigger and greater.
Yeah.
And so, you know, people at my company and some of my peers, you know, we do pull requests, we go to Git. Sometimes you may only see a typo in the documentation, but you can now put in your pull request to say, listen, I know how your documentation could be better, and it gets accepted, and you're able to be a part of something bigger. So I enjoy that portion of it.
Yeah. You're helping build something, right? And building that knowledge and that community up.
Right.
And that repository of information that's available to everyone.
Yes.
Like you said, and that sharing that's existing. Any common threads or trends or things that you're hearing or seeing at the conference or in your session that people are particularly interested in or kind of hot topics right now that you're hearing about?
Sure. Well, surprisingly, and I've been doing some speaker one-on-ones, and I gave a couple different areas. I gave the area of DevOps, which I thought was going to be flooded with people, but it wasn't.
Really?
And best practice in test automation. And to tell you the truth, test automation is still extremely popular. There's still so many, there's still a lot of room for innovation.
Mm-hmm.
And the need to understand the best practices there.
Mm-hmm.
People that I've spoken to this entire time are asking me about automation.
Yeah.
How do I get started? What tools should I use? When I experience this problem, how have you resolved it?
Yeah.
So automation is still a hot topic, and it's not going anywhere.
No.
And the next step, and this is what I you know, encourage the audience that's listening, is to understand that your automation, it's kind of like if a tree falls in the forest and nobody's there, did they hear? Right?
Yeah.
I don't know if that saying is, I have maybe Bushism. But the thing to note is if you're creating your automation and you don't have the reporting capabilities and you're not integrated with the CI system, it's almost as if it doesn't exist at all.
Right.
And so even though there wasn't very many people that wanted to talk to me about DevOps, it's something that people need to remember, that it's the next step.
Yep.
When you have your automation, the next thing you need to do is be prepared to integrate it with your development team, with your operations team, because it's a critical piece that unfortunately is sometimes not thought too much of in certain organizations, but it's a critical piece in continuous deployment.
Mm-hmm.
If an organization wants to get there, they're going to have automation integrated.
Absolutely. We are out of time. If we just scratched the surface, and I have so many more questions I want to ask you. If people want to get a hold of you or want more information, what is the best way to contact you?
The best way is to follow me on Twitter and
Perfect.
Give a direct message at Queen of Agile QA.
Queen of Agile QA.
I am the queen.
I love it. Queen of Agile QA.
Self-assigned Queen of Agile QA.
That's wonderful. Awesome. Well, thank you so much for being here with us.
Thank you.
I appreciate it.